what's the definition of your day? I don't like execs and agents and managers and so on.
I just sort of think you know, every film is,
everybody aspires to an element of genre, right. And they're trying.
I don't know. I think a lot of people mean it because they simply see the cast, right? So I think there's somebody going, okay, well, how did you get this cast, right? Because they should be doing something like this, that, you know what I mean? And then I think they hear me talk about the film, and then I think they go, oh, okay. Well, they see the film, and they kind of see the themes, or, you know, detect that sense there's a theme there. And I think they go, oh, okay, there's something different there. And, you know, and then I think, I don't know, but I think, you know, we delay so much. The first act, I push it as close as I can to the 30-minute mark. You know, it goes really close. And a lot of the first acts are ending on the 20-minute mark, or 22-minute mark. We're ending right there. They want it to be quicker. So they say to you, quicker. Get to the chase, get to the scares quicker. And again, we resisted that as well. But I don't know. The sense that I get really from this elevated genre just means that you're more argumentative about your work. That's the sense that I get, honestly. That you're kind of like going, you know, like, I was adamant that film, that the song at the end, Bonobo, you know, that kind of house song. I'm adamant that that's how I wanted the film to end. They were saying, well, you know, it sounds like he was going to the club. I'm going, are you insane? You know, did you see the opening, the opening Olympics, where it was music that we brought up to them as kids, you know, it was all acid house and all that kind of stuff. There's nothing wrong with that music, you know? And that's why, and so I really held on to that. I was like, no, that's how we're going to close the film. And he looks up, and he's Bonobo, and they didn't even know who he is, but I know who he is, and that's all that matters to me. So it seems to be, if I'm honest with you, you want to do things your way, and you hold on to that. That's what elevated genre really seems to me to be all about, where you kind of go, no, I'm not going to cast, you know, Lily Collins, I'm going to cast Jennifer Lawrence, and you know, to hell with you. You know what I mean? That's what it seems to be. That's what it seems to be. I know it's ridiculous, but that's what it seems to be. Right?
Is there a space, like, for a sequence?
A sequel? I'm not with me. I don't think it's not for me.
Okay.
I think they've left it open just in case.
What are you working on now?
I'm doing a pilot at the moment, and I'm doing a script that goes out today, actually, called Terror of Living, which is an adaptation of a book that I really want to do as my third film. It's more like a thriller in terms of, you know, it's more like Charlie Barrack, all these old films that I used to watch as a kid. So I'm really excited by that. It's only been shown to WME as well now. So it went really well. So I'm hoping that will be my next film. I'm really excited about it. It's a tremendous book by a guy called Urban Ways. So I'm hoping that's my next one. But who knows? If this film doesn't do well, then I'll be on a plane back to England. If this film does well, then you know things will change.
Can you talk about the process of coming up with the Bible when you get these scripts and how you come up with the vision for?
Truthfully, when I get a film, a script, it's not really about the plot, because then the plot you can fix. It's really what it's trying to say. And this film was, I just had a kid, we just fallen pregnant. And this film was very specific for me, talking about parents' love and how it can hurt you or help you become the person you are. And I thought it was quite a powerful thing to talk about. Not without sort of hitting your audience in the head with it, you know what I mean? Just if you've got something like theme, you're good. So that's where I started with the theme. That's where I always start with the theme. And then if everybody has the same theme, especially your producers, right, you're unstoppable. Because you're all building the same house, right? And that's why I did all the producers. That's why I first started with the theme, and we all agree what the theme is. Because it's their film as much as it is mine. You know, especially the producers, especially how Hollywood is now, you know? Where, you know, directors now, it's really about collaboration, right? Not how it was in the past, where it was a dictatorship. Now you've got to work with these people, and it's important. They understand that it's their film. So that's where we start. So everybody knows what the theme is. And then from the theme, I start to go out from the character work and how everything that people do on the set, like if you press pause on any of the scenes, especially in Ryan's room, all the photographs of people dressed as women, you know, everything is there, you know? So everything about the set, you know, even when he's on the laptop buying something, or she comes to the door, he's actually buying the stuff that knocks them out, you know? Every single detail, filmmaking is detail for me. So every detail that people, every decision everybody's making, from production design to the gaffer, everybody, it's all about feeding that narrative. So to do that, everybody's got to have a real handle on what the character is. So we've got a character name, so we spend a long time on character. So they don't have to ask me, they have to say, you know, what kind of shirt are you wearing, you know, how have you got that shirt, you know, it's like he's wearing his father's shirts because we know what's happened to him, you know. So we go from that, and then we can carry on all the way through, and that just spins off, so the character spins off, and then we go into the production side of it and talk about, you know, the lighting, talking about the design, and then costume is really important, you know. Makeup is really important, right? Especially when you do a film with women. know, for me, the real trick isn't getting the person that's best in their hair and makeup. That's not what you want. The last place they go before they come on set is the makeup chair. You want a girl who can talk. That's what you want, right? You want a girl who can talk. So when they sit in the makeup chair, they're just talking, right? So when they go on set, they're just in a great place, you know? And that's how you choose, that's how, especially when you're looking at girls. There are so many costume changes, girls, and, you know, they're a bit longer than men, so you've got to have it right, you know? And it's all about getting them on set, you know, so they're just in a really comfortable, secure place that they can do what they do. And so then we go all the way through, and then right at the end of that Bible is actually a bit on distribution, which of course we didn't have at the time. But again, how you sell the film, I think, is just as important. You know, it's just this massively long, you know, 2 years now, you know, longer actually. And I think the film's been sitting on the shelf for a year because we need the Hunger Games to come through its cycle. You know? Can't believe how frustrating it is.
What is it like on the chemistry between Jennifer and Max?
Oh, I thought it was amazing. When I did the kissing scene, I didn't have to know action. I remember looking up and going, okay, so we're ready, and they were kissing. You know? And I remember thinking, oh, okay, that's interesting. So yeah, I thought they, and again, you don't know that until you know it, right? And I thought it was great. I think you really believe, I think is the answer to that, you really believe in this situation with this kid, that he lives there. And you really, even though you know what's happened to him, even though you know what he's been through, I think you really buy the fact that she would fall for him, you know? That is what really matters to me, you know, and I'm hoping that our target audience is looking at it and going, well, oh, I really like that, I really like, you know, I like him as well, you know, I want to hug him as well, you know, so yeah.
It'd be interesting, you say you didn't have to call action, but did you have to call cut, or did you? But something else you said struck a chord with me about being inspired by the fact that you were about to become a parent, because I thought that the parents come off. It is the view, I think, that a lot of young people have of their parents, that they're not there for me, right, or that they were so into themselves, in this case, because of the scene that you show while they're on the swing.
Right.
And I wondered about that, about whether you think that that's something that does particularly resonate with young people, or that maybe was something of a concern to you of how good a parent will I be?
Well, it's interesting, because I think you're right on all fronts. You know, I think, you know, for example, let's talk about the parents of the other kids in the film. And for me, I think, you know, society sometimes creates its own monster by ostracizing. They really create Brian. You know, well, they have a hand in it, you know what I mean? Which is frankly something monster, you know? So that was one area of it, you know? I also think, you know, it's a line where Elizabeth Shue says, you know, some people can't be saved, and you can't save everybody, you know? And I think that's very important. I don't know about you guys, but I've had friends where, you know, I've always thought, well, hang on, I've got to cut you off this morning because, you know, it's too much, right? You know? I've had that. I've had it with family. And so, you know, for me, you know, areas of that, and, you know, it's Elizabeth Shue was never there for Jennifer. You know, she brought her up, you know, and she's used her clothes. And we did all this work on it, but it was always the other way around. You know? Suddenly this woman wants to become a parent. It's too late, right? You know? Suddenly engage. That's what happened. And so, you know, I felt very much that if we could do that, and kids especially could see maybe their relationships, or could see different aspects of the relationship with their parents on that. You know, at the end of the film, you know, the mum and daughter are not, you know, they're not, I don't think they're in a better place, they're just in a different place, you know? And I think it's really important. You know, I think she, you know, she realizes at the end, they'll never see the world the same way. But that's all right, do you know what I mean? And so yeah, I mean, it's difficult. And the thing about it is, if I'm honest with you, you know, it's great talking about it, but, you know, I hope that the audience never, I don't want to ever be preaching to the audience or be ever kind of like hitting them on the head with all this sort of stuff, you know? I don't think it does work that way. I think you feel something. This might be the answer to the elevated genre. Maybe when you're watching the elevated genre, maybe you can feel that the film's not just about what you're seeing, it's something else there, some other beat is there. You can't, and, you know, hopefully you can feel that. I don't think you want to articulate it, you just know, you kind of go, you know, like those scenes, those Face of the Tree scenes, they're not really in films like this, you know? Do you know what I mean? And I think that maybe that's what it is. Maybe it's the fact that, kind of, you know, there's a beating heart there that they can feel but they can't quite articulate. You know? I mean, I've never had anybody come up to me and go, oh, your film's about parents' love. No, but that's great. But if they've always gone, you know, oh, it's really good, it's really interesting. Yeah, there's no, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Well, so, yeah, the film is through the point of view of Lawrence's character a lot, primarily. But,
right.
But her mom is sort of proven right.
Right. Right. Which is interesting, right? Yeah. Which is really interesting, right? You know, it's like, you know, and at the end of the, yeah, you know, it's like, yeah, I think that's a really valid point. She's going, well, you know, I told you this, you know, let's keep going. And I think, you know, she would do it again, you know, because I think she's like that, you know, maybe some people can reach out, you know. Yeah.
I like the idea that you'll...
I think you'll be very comfortable here.
Mom, this is beautiful.
Everyone, this is Sarah Cassidy and her daughter Alyssa. They're our new neighbors.
Hey, I'm Jillian.
Hey,
this is
Ryan Jacobson.
I live next door. I heard you singing this morning.
You can hear me all the way from your house?
It was nice.
I like the way you see things. I like the way you see me.
Why is Ryan Jacobson still living there?
What exactly happened there?
His parents were murdered, and his sister disappeared.
Do you hear something?
But they never found her body.
Tough, tough life.
Hey, look, the freak finally decided to show up.
No, stop! What are you doing?
I'm so sorry.
He's really sad, and he's all by himself in this big house. I do not want the two of you to be alone in his house.
Listen, we have a new neighbor, okay? Her name's Alyssa, and her mom just moved into Reed's house. I want you to leave her alone, you understand me?
I know what you're doing. You're trying to save him. Sometimes people can't be fixed.
My mom said she didn't want us alone.
We're not really alone.
Brian?
Alyssa, is she here?
No, ma'am.